RH, quer saber como voar no trabalho? É só usar a Flash. Com a Flash, você concentra toda a gestão de pessoas em um único lugar. Faça admissão dos colaboradores e solicite mais de 8 categorias de benefícios. Ah, e você ainda pode fazer todo o controle de ponto. Conheça o novo onboarding integrado da Flash em flashapp.com.br.
Feisty, fearless, and fair. She's an Emmy-winning journalist from the White House to war zones, telling all sides of the story. This is the Rita Cosby Show.
I know your name is Rita, 'cause your perfume is smelling sweet. Since when I saw you down on the floor.
Breaking news.
And tonight on the Rita Cosby Show, it seems like the last 24 hours have been filled with indictments. And the latest one, this is interesting. This is coming from Politico, just crossing a couple minutes ago, that multiple Iranian nationals have now been indicted on criminal charges related to the regime's hacking of former President Trump. Remember, they got into the hacking of his campaign. Apparently, they got information of a number of campaign officials talking left and right. And then they shared that information with the Biden campaign. Isn't it interesting? The Biden campaign haven't said anything about it. We don't know what the information was. We don't know if they used the information. There are so many questions about that tonight. But we do know that the Iranians apparently hacked into it. That came out. But what's interesting is apparently they have now indicted these individuals. There's a federal grand jury that has signed off on the indictment. And I guess those charges are going to be announced tomorrow, according to multiple reports by the Justice Department. And that would be really interesting. It's sort of that cyber operation, if you will, against the Trump campaign, stealing information from his team and offering it apparently to media outlets and also President Biden's campaign at the time. So this is, the plot is thickening. Will we get the names? Will we find out how high up this goes in the Iranian regime? And where were these individuals when they did it? How did they do it? And what else have they had access to? And this comes as President Trump has been pounding his fist and saying, what the heck is going on here? Not only have they hacked the campaign, but they also have been trying to assassinate President Trump. And today he was talking about how there was the threat, of course, from the Iranians. Remember, they arrested that guy who was from Pakistan, but he was being hired by the Iranian regime, and that person played a role and should have heightened security for the Butler PA rally. That would have sent alarm bells, that's for sure. And then also this other guy, remember, it's weird, the guy down in Florida, and I'm not a big conspiracy theorist, guys, you know that, but the guy down in Florida, remember, had some Iran ties because he was recruiting Afghan fighters to fight in Ukraine and then somehow traveled through Iran. Some of them got stuck in Iran and were complaining to him because they got stuck in Iran. And then he also wrote these notes that said that, I'm so sorry, Iran, essentially, that I wasn't able to kill Trump. You could kill us both. So why was he so fixated, or was he in communication with Iran? We don't know. I mean, there's a lot of questions here. But the one thing that President Trump has been pounding his fist about, and it's rightfully so, the Iran leader was in New York spewing hate there at the UNGA, at the United Nations General Assembly. Tomorrow, finally, we're going to hear from Israel. I can't wait to hear that speech because Netanyahu's a warrior out there. So that'll be great to hear his speech tomorrow. I think it'll be a little different than the Iranian president's speech. But President Trump has been saying, where are the pounding of the fists from Kamala Harris and Joe Biden? There have been now two assassination attempts against him. You've got Iran hacking into the campaigns with this brand new indictment that we're talking about tonight. So why aren't they complaining and saying, protect President Trump at all costs? Why is this not? It's an American, former American president who has had two assassination attempts against him. It's outrageous. It's all because of politics. They're trying not to bring attention to these assassination attempts. And they're also heightening the rhetoric. Gina Raimondo, who is the Commerce Secretary for President Biden, was saying the other day that Trump should be extinguished. That kind of rhetoric when you've got these crazies out there and these paid assassins like Iranians, I mean, that is downright dangerous. So here is President Trump saying, you know what? You should be pounding your fists and demanding protection for the former president of the United States and likely the future one, because it's America under assault, not just them. Take a listen. Here is what President Trump said.
If I were president and a former president and a leading candidate, I'm the leading candidate by far to be the next president. And that leading candidate was under threat. If I was president and the candidate was under threat, any candidate, Republican or Democrat. And by the way, I want to thank the Democrats because they just increased funding for the Secret Service, who work very hard. They increased funding for the Secret Service. And nobody will believe this. It was a unanimous vote. Republicans, every single Republican, every single Democrat present voted in favor. That was the first unanimous vote we've seen in a long time. And that's to increase the funding of the Secret Service. So I thank everybody in Congress. But if I were the president, I would inform the threatening country, in this case, Iran, that if you do anything to harm this person, we are going to blow your largest cities and the country itself to smithereens. We're going to blow it to smithereens. You can't do that. And there would be no more threats. There would be no more threats. But right now, we don't have that leadership or the necessary people, the necessary leaders. We have two people, not one. We don't even know who our president is right now. Who is our president right now? We really don't know, but we have two people, not one, that only keep looking. And when you do that, when you just look, trouble always ensues. So it's big trouble for our country. Meanwhile, we have the president of Iran in our country this week. We have large security forces guarding him, and yet they're threatening our former president and the leading candidate to become the next president of the United States. Certainly a strange set of circumstances.
And by the way, speaking of Biden, President Biden tonight at an event, he referred to Vice President Kamala Harris as his boss. And then when he was describing Ohio Senator and Trump's running mate, J.D. Vance, at that same event, he called him secretary. So he's Trump's right. Who is running the show? Clearly, the titles somehow are getting mismanaged. He called her president. Remember, that was not that long ago, too. So things are really in trouble there at the White House. There is no doubt. But this is darn right dangerous. And General Keith Kellogg, who was Trump's national security advisor and also there with Vice President Pence, too, as well. But he was there at the National Security Council during that time. He said, it is obscene with all these threats from Iran. And we just talked again about that indictment, the new one with the hacking. But with all these threats, these death threats against President Trump, which should have heightened and raised the red flags at that Butler rally. Well, he is saying that this is nothing short than an act of war, and that this president, our current president, President Biden, needs to wake up and start acting like a commander in chief. Listen to this.
You know, the threats are obviously nearly, you know, they had two assassination attempts on them, and clearly there's a threat out there. You know, this was an opportunity for President Biden. Just this last couple of days when he was up at the UN General Assembly there in New York City to pull aside, you know, the Iranian president, President Pezeshkian, and say to him, look, bud, let's take a walk. Put his arm around his shoulder and say, you need to understand something, that if you threaten, and I don't care if your third cousin threatens to harm, kill, maul, maim an American politician of any type, then it is going to be a state of war between us and Iran.
That's the kind of language that we need from leadership at the top. 1-800-848-9222. 1-800-848-9222. Let's go to Donnie in New Jersey. Donnie, feel free to talk about Trump, Adams, whatever you want.
Yeah, I agree with everything you just said, but I do want to talk about Adams because this is so scary to me. I mean, we have a person, and I'm hardcore MAGA. I don't love Democrats, okay? I'm just saying that Adams is a national hero for daring to stand up against this Biden-Harris regime. He dared to stand up, just like this guy Blagojevich from Illinois, just like Steve Bannon, just like Donald J. Trump. All these people had the spine and the courage. I don't know what Adams, if he did anything, I don't know why he would take the stance. If he did anything wrong, then, you know, it wasn't such a smart move on his part, because we know what they do to people that they have stuff on. You know how it works in Congress. In Congress, if they know, if they have stuff on you, they're going to come to you with the suits. We know about this. We have stuff on you with the little folders, and you have to vote this way. That's how it works in D.C., and now it's spreading everywhere across the country.
So you believe that Adams is courageous because he spoke out about the migrant crisis?
Absolutely.
Now, don't
Whether
do that, by the way.
Not,
by the
I
way,
mean, he didn't do anything about it. But
yeah, that's my point. And that's why it's sort of like, you know, two heads of the coin, because he did incentivize them to come. He advertised, hey, listen, come to the free hotels. Here's the nice 4 or 5 star hotel. You know, he brought him here. I will say, yeah, I'm glad that he did speak out, because New York at that point, and still by far, is busting at the seams. I mean, there's no end in sight. Yeah. I wish he had done that to day one, don't you?
100%. I don't know what his brain is going through right now to just stand up for this. Maybe it's just a political move. Maybe. I don't know. But what I do know is the investigation started when he was on that plane into D.C. You know, there's been stories. The IRS shows up at the door of people that were testifying before Congress. This, we are living in a banana republic, and it's scary. It doesn't matter whether he's doing the right things or the wrong things. The fact is that this government is going after sitting mayors. They're going after former presidents. How could anyone stand by and just allow this to happen? This should be a blowout election for Donald J. Trump. It just doesn't make sense to me that people are looking at this. People in New York, you have to wake up. Democrats, wake up. This is a time that our country is going down the road of no return. You have to look at this and just see it for what it is. You speak up against this administration, you are going to go to jail. This is not normal.
Yeah, it is not normal. And Donnie, you're absolutely right. The targeting and the lawfare that we are seeing is so over the top and so blatant, I think, especially in so many cases. And in fact, you brought up Trump, because today he was not him, but his attorneys were in court over that. Remember that whole deal with the New York case where the judge Engoron, it's a $454 million judgment, because the judge is saying his Mar-a-Lago property isn't $18 million, he's saying it was $18 million. But if you look at Mar-a-Lago, trust me, there's probably at least a zero after that, if not more. And yet, it's just the most ridiculous suit that came about. And that, remember, the judge made a decision before it even went before testimony or a trial. He said, oh yeah, we'll find a declarative, he's guilty, now let's just kind of move on. He was so in the tank to go up against Trump. And earlier today I was figuring out the amount. It's $115,000 a day in interest that they're also charging this case. And if you look at it, it's so blatant. They wouldn't go after anybody else for, and in fact, on a number of things where President Trump, he has a property like it's the old post office in Washington, D.C. That one, he happened to undervalue. I think he listed that one for like $100 million, and it sold for $400 million. So in a way, they probably owe him money if that's the deal, you know, for underinflating. But because he's Trump, they're creating all this stuff. And you're right, this lawfare is so disgusting and it's so blatant. And you see it all over the place with Trump on so many of these cases. And the question is it now happening to Eric Adams? And you're right, he has started to speak out and suddenly these things come against him. So you have to definitely wonder the timing. 1-800-848-9222. We're going to continue, everybody, after the break.
You're listening to The Rita Cosby Show.
Uma pausa no seu podcast para contar que chegou o novo Peugeot 2008. Um carro que impressiona até quem já viu de tudo. Conheça uma experiência de puro prazer em dirigir com acabamento sofisticado e design inconfundível. Descubra como conforto e tecnologia podem elevar o nível da sua experiência de direção. Conheça o novo Peugeot 2008 e deixe a inspiração te guiar.
This is the Rita Cosby Show.
And we are talking about Donald Trump dealing with the politics against him and also all these attacks against him. And also now Eric Adams says that he is a victim of the dirty justice system. And for speaking out about the migrant crisis, this is the payback, now the indictments. Also, by the way, coming up in about 7-8 minutes or so, we're going to be talking with Ambassador David Friedman. He was the ambassador under President Trump from the U.S. to Israel, and he's going to preview Netanyahu. He's going to be speaking at the U.N. tomorrow. Lots of protests all over New York City, all over the country today. And tomorrow, no doubt, there will be a lot as well. And we're going to be talking with him about his thoughts about that and what Israel needs to do as it is on the front lines right now on the war on terror, fighting Iran, which is funding all of these different proxy groups all over the place, including Hezbollah, Hamas, and the Houthis. 1-800-848-9222. Let's go to Joaquin. What do you think, Joaquin?
Oh, Rita, the first thing is this. They're going after Mayor Adams deliberately because he did stand against, you know, he wanted to protect New York City, but he did not go far enough because he never called for the closing of the border. But then I also wanted to touch on one other thing. This whole thing about the Iranians attempting to assassinate Donald Trump, I'm sorry, but there is an establishment here that will at least turn a blind eye to it because it will accomplish the, you know, what they need to have accomplished to stop Donald Trump from getting back to the White House. So I think that this is really just a smokescreen that's being thrown up.
Wow. Yeah. You know, what's interesting, Joaquin, and I normally like would go, oh, no. But I agree with you. It seems like they are trying any which way but loose. They also put out that letter. Remember the letter that had the sort of the bounty, if you will, from that crazy guy in Florida. And a lot of people thought that's over the top. It's sort of inspiring these crazies and turning a blind eye to these others. And also, we haven't heard really anything great about new security against President Trump. I mean, you know, they said they had great security, especially in Florida. If that was great security, the guy was hanging out there having breakfast, lunch, and dinner by that fence line. So you're right. And that's a sad place to be by far. Let's go to John in Long Island. John, your thoughts?
Yeah, in regards to dirty politics, don't be surprised if Mayor Adams, with all the frustration, everyone's basically leaving him flat, and he might come back and support Trump.
Oh, John, that's interesting. What? So maybe what Mayor Eric Adams, if Trump gets into the White House and the polls are looking good for him, what, he brings in Mayor Eric Adams as what? What position? His Justice Department? He leads the Justice Department? Who knows, guys?
Rita Cosby is on.
And welcome back to the Rita Cosby Show. Well, Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has just arrived in New York as he will address the UN General Assembly tomorrow. And the Prime Minister is vowing the full force of Israel will be used against the Hezbollah terrorists, who, of course, are backed by Iran. And joining us now to talk about this and also his awesome new book is Ambassador David Friedman. He served as the U.S. ambassador to Israel under President Trump. He was there from 2017 to 2021. And his brand new book is called One Jewish State, The Last Best Hope to Resolve the Israeli-Palestinian Conflict. Ambassador Friedman, so great to have you here. And first off, what do you think we will hear tomorrow from Prime Minister Netanyahu?
Well, thanks, Rita. It's great to be with you. And look, I'm expecting a pretty combative Netanyahu. I mean, he's showing up really into the lion's den, into the United Nations. This is a place that normally is not not friendly to Israel, but right now, I mean, everybody's got their anger directed at Israel, and you know, unjustifiably. So I think he's gonna just kind of lay it out to the fact that Israel has been under constant attack from Hezbollah now for 11 months. He's given all his friends, including the Biden administration, every opportunity to negotiate some sort of a diplomatic resolution. Israel has no territorial aspirations towards Lebanon. They want nothing to do with Lebanon. They just don't want to be attacked. And Biden has sent all kinds of envoys and delegates to try to make a deal with Hezbollah, and it's failed. And finally, he's got 60,000 people who have been displaced from their homes in the north, refugees in their own country. And finally, Israel said, enough. And they have attacked Hezbollah with great creativity, great ingenuity. I mean, everybody knows about the beepers and the walkie-talkies and all the other incredible, daring efforts to destroy Hezbollah. And now Biden and Macron want to ceasefire. Well, you know what? Israel's finally winning for a change. It's finally, pushing Hezbollah back. And I don't think he's in the mood for a ceasefire right now. And I think he's going to, I think he's going to lay it all out there in his speech at the UN.
Yeah, I do, too. And look at the times. I mean, as we're seeing, because as we talked about Hezbollah, you know all too well, Ambassador Friedman, that, of course, it's Iran who's backing Hezbollah. They're backing the Hamas. They're backing the Houthis. And yet we've also seen Iran has been trying to assassinate the former president of the United States, Donald Trump. I mean, it's a pretty black and white situation here.
Look, America has an ally that is really doing all its work for it, because Biden and Harris are so feckless and so impotent in terms of confronting our enemies that it's all on Israel's shoulders. And, Israel's got a strong military, but it's a tiny little place. It's only the size of New Jersey. And it's bad enough that, Israel is fighting the world's battles, the Western world's battles. But on top of that, they want to handcuff Israel because they've got an election coming up. And they don't want to be accused of fostering yet another battle. But, Netanyahu's responsibility is to the citizens of Israel. He's got to keep them safe. He's got to restore security to the north. The war in Gaza is probably winding down, but not over yet. But Hezbollah is an incredibly strong, powerful military. It's the strongest non-state army in the world. It's got over 100,000 soldiers, 150,000 rockets. And no one has been successful in pushing them back at all. And Israel is now taking it upon itself. And I think we should wish them luck. That's it.
I agree, by the way. It's such an extraordinary effort that they have been doing. And as you point out, they feel Israel feels it sadly has to do it on its own. And it's incredible what it is doing on its own. I want to also get into this with you, Ambassador, because you were such a big part, I know, of the historic Abraham Accords with Israel and Arab countries. That was an amazing time, huge accomplishments by you and President Trump and others to make that happen. Why were those successful? And why do you think some of the other sort of plans in the past failed? Why were they successful? And what could be the template for the future? You talk about it in your book, One Jewish State.
Look, the reason why so many Arab nations, so many moderate Arab nations were willing to normalize with Israel and make peace with Israel was because Israel was perceived by them to be an incredibly strong partner, a bulwark against their common enemies in Iran. And that came about because in the Trump administration, there was no daylight between America and Israel. There was unqualified, unapologetic support by America for Israel, whether in Jerusalem, the Golan Heights, Judea and Samaria. I mean, America supported Israel, and the UAE and other countries said, you know what? We want to get in on this relationship. We want to be close to America like Israel is. We want to be part of this circle of trust. And so that's how this came from. It may be counterintuitive to people that don't know the region, but actually, it's the right way to go about making peace. What Biden and Harris have done is they feel somehow by criticizing Israel, by keeping Israel at arm's length, is somehow showing that they're balanced and they're kind of, you know, creating more of a balance in the Middle East. Just the opposite. The more they push Israel away, the more they create uncertainty and more radicalization. I mean, Israel is the foundation of democracy, strength, and peace in the Middle East. The more you embrace Israel, the more you embrace those values. The more you push them away, as Biden and Harris are doing, the more you end up in the kind of ridiculous upside-down world that we have today.
You know, one of the things you talk about in your book, One Jewish State, is American evangelicals and their influence. How important is it that the U.S. public get behind it? I'll tell you, I get disgusted, and I know you do too, Ambassador, when I see these crazy protests on college campuses and elsewhere with them parading the Hamas flags and everything else. It's just, it's disgusting and it's horrible. And to me, it's really stunning. But there are a lot of groups that are very stalwart and supportive of Israel.
Look, I've been speaking at a lot of churches lately. They've embraced the thesis of my book, The One Jewish State Plan. They've been incredible friends. They are our best friends in America. And America, you know, by and large, still overwhelmingly supports Israel, even if the leadership doesn't. I mean, it's 75-80% support Israel versus its enemies. The Christians in America have been great friends of Israel, and it's not just based on politics or self-interest. It's based on faith, and that's the strongest of commitments, and I share that with them.
Yeah, you certainly do, in a big way. And boy, I can't think of a more important time to be relaying that message. Ambassador David Friedman, we got to get you back on again soon. Again, the book is called One Jewish State. And I want to say bravo to you. I saw you were named by the Jerusalem Post, right, as one of the most influential Jews in the world. And you were number one in 2020. So that's amazing. That's amazing.
Thank you. Thank you, Rita. Great to be with you.
And of course, again, thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador. Tomorrow, we will hear from Benjamin Netanyahu, a real warrior out there who feels he does have to go it alone because he can't count on the Biden-Harris administration. 1-800-848-9222. 1-800-848-9222. And we are also talking about the indictment against Mayor Eric Adams. It just came down a few hours ago. By the way, tomorrow he is supposed to be arraigned. What an incredible moment. He's expected to show up in court tomorrow and will be arraigned at some point. He'll be booked. He'll be fingerprinted. That could happen tomorrow or in the coming days. I mean, what an extraordinary moment. No doubt he is going to plead not guilty. And he says he is fighting this tooth and nail. Here's a little bit. Here is Damian Williams. He is, of course, the U.S. attorney who came down hard on Eric Adams. But this is far from over. Eric Adams, we might see an Eric Adams-Trump team up because they're both saying that they are victims of sort of a dirty political judicial system. And here is Damian Williams today talking about the case he says is against Eric Adams.
These are bright red lines. And we allege that the mayor crossed them again and again for years. That is the only reason we are here today. Second, this investigation continues. We continue to dig, and we will hold more people accountable.
And I want to go to cut 16. This is Eric Adams' attorney, Alex Spiro, because he says, you know, yeah, it sounds really good. It comes down from the U.S. attorney's office. But when you break it all down, the indictment is very thin. And it's not like at first he was saying, oh, it's $10 million. It's this, it's that. And he said, when you break it all down, it's not that much. Take a listen.
And they shift to the campaign contributions. And I don't know if you noticed, but they don't have Eric Adams doing anything. He's not taking in the money. There's no email or text message in the indictment that has him doing anything, taking in any money. What they say is that some staffer says sometime later that he knew that some of the money was foreign money. That's the case. But they left out something very important, something you will soon see, which is that there are emails with Mayor Adams telling all of them, do not take foreign money, period. That's in emails. You will see those. And so they pivot away from that. They pivot away from that and they say $10 million fraud, $10 million fraud. And they're doing that to mislead you. If you look closely at the indictment, you know how much money we're talking about from the people of Turkey? $26,000. That's what's actually in the indictment. No $10 million.
So is Eric Adams a victim of an overzealous judicial system by his enemies? Remember, the U.S. attorney is appointed by the Biden administration, and he's only going to be there a few more months because after everything goes down, and say if Trump goes into the White House, he can appoint his own people, and then they all resign at, essentially, it's protocol. The new person comes in, and they end up resigning if it's a different administration. Very unlikely, obviously, that a Trump would keep a Damian Williams, especially now after what he is seeing here. By the way, I thought it was really interesting. The last caller, one of you guys brought up the idea, maybe Eric Adams will endorse Trump. Maybe he'll really go on the Trump train and say, look, we are both victims of overzealous prosecution. Here's a little bit more from Adams' attorney saying, the indictment is thin.
Let's take a second and step back and look at this. Look at the flights. That's what they want to talk about. The travel, the expenses. The flight they talk about, that free flight, is in 2017. 7 years ago, 5 years before he's the mayor. There's nothing improper, illegal, or wrong about that. But they don't want you to look at that too long. So they go over to their board, and they showed you that chart where they have the columns of the places and the costs and the places and the costs. But you know what they didn't really explain to all of you? Those were upgrades. Those were upgrades on airlines with open seats. That's what airlines do. They do it every day. They do it for VIPs. They do it for Congress people. They're empty seats. It costs the airlines nothing. That's what airlines do. And so that's what they want to talk about because they want to tarnish him. They want to tarnish him in your eyes.
So was this all overzealous political enhancement all done to essentially go after Mayor Eric Adams? He's saying he's going to fight this tooth and nail. And knowing Mayor Eric Adams, that is going to happen. I think he is definitely going to go tooth and nail on this. And he is also, by the way, in the middle of all this, he's got this attorney, Alex Spiro, who's a pretty well-known attorney, very, very feisty, very spirited, kind of the attack dog, well-known attorney. He's clearly saying, you know what? He looked smiling after the indictment came down today. I was watching him. And I was watching Eric Adams sort of going, this is it. Granted, there could be more coming. There's other districts out there. This is the U.S. Southern District of New York. There's the Eastern District and other districts that could be loading up with other charges. But if you come out with something kind of weak out of the gate, it sends a little bit of a tone for other things. And here is Judge Jeanine Pirro with her take right after the indictment came down. She said, there's not much there either.
You know, my take is very interesting to me because, you know, I'm a prosecutor. And when a grand jury indicts, they indict because they think someone is guilty. But I got to tell you, with this new weaponization of the Justice Department, and this is the Joe Biden Justice Department, when you look at these crimes, you say to yourself, okay, wait a minute. The guy went first class instead of economy. And I'm looking at the count regarding, you know, occupying a Turkish consulate, occupying a sky scraper that had not yet passed a fire and safety inspection. Mm-hmm. What does that mean? Was it coming anyway? Mm-hmm. Was he checking on it? Mm-hmm. Was everybody thinking that, you know, something illegal was going on? Did they pay them to approve the fire inspection? I don't know, but I have a bad feeling about this. I don't like this straw contributors. It's like a straw purchaser for a gun. In other words, I cannot legally give you money because I'm from a foreign country, but I'm going to pick John Jones, give him the money, and he'll give it to you. I don't like that, because then it kicks in matching funds, and that's where we get into fraud. But, you know, I was an elected official, and I had all kinds of disclosures that I had to file every year. What a pain they were. But, you know, I went, they moved me, they bumped me up from business, from economy. You know, well, what did you do? I mean, you better tell them that the U.S. attorney better be real clear on what they have. I think the problem is all of the little minions around Eric Adams are scared to death. They're going to throw him under the bus.
And there's a lot of them that are clearly in the snare of the U.S. attorney. But I agree with Judge Jeanine. I don't like the idea of these foreign donations. But then when I heard that a lot of this was sort of like a pump up from, you know, economy to business class, that he got a perk because maybe somebody recognized he was the mayor of New York City, or maybe they did him a favor because the seat was available. You just heard the attorney's point was that it doesn't cost them anything when you bump somebody up. So, I mean, it seems to me there's a lot of stuff in there. This seems like a lot of a stretch. 1-800-848-9222. And now to our support our heroes.
The Rita Cosby Show presents Support Our Heroes.
And this is the Tunnel to Towers Foundation Support Our Heroes segment with a really powerful story from Coral Gables, Florida, where loved ones came together there for a special salute to a local World War II veteran ahead of his centennial celebration, and he's being honored for his service and sacrifice. Surrounded by family members, veteran Norton Pallett proudly wore his red, white, and blue. And also, just to give you a little background, he is turning 100 in November. He was drafted in 1942, and he bravely served the United States in World War II. His sister, who was also there, said, "Boy, I remember it like it was yesterday. We were so worried because we didn't have a lot of information. It was covered every night in the news. We would sit by the radio. I was so proud, so very proud of him." Also, his wife was also there, and she shared her thoughts about everything and the honor to her great husband. She said, she turned to her husband, she smiled, and she simply said, "He is my hero." What a beautiful story. And I love seeing members of the greatest generation honored so beautifully. And everybody, all it takes is just $11 a month. Donate $11 a month to the great Tunnel to Towers Foundation. Be sure to check them out at T2T.org, T2T.org. And when we come back, we'll continue with your calls about this indictment of Eric Adams. Does he and Trump, do they have something in common?
You're listening to The Rita Cosby Show. It's The Rita Cosby Show.
So where is this indictment headed against Mayor Eric Adams? Tomorrow he will be arraigned. That will be an incredible moment to see that he would have to be in court. They will hear the charges against him. And it looks like he will resoundingly say not guilty. And he's saying he's not going anywhere for now. The question is, can the city function at a time where it is in complete disarray, like many great American cities? And crime is plaguing it. Migrants. There are so many problems in New York. And can he do two things at once? Well, a lot of people are saying, well, look, he can do more than just defend himself. Look what President Trump has done. President Trump, think about what he's been doing. He's been running on the campaign trail nonstop. He's been juggling more than one case. Adams right now just has this one. But Trump has had a million different cases that he's been juggling, like going from one to the other to the other. And again, also doing debates and going out to rallies left and right. So could Eric Adams look at the Trump model? 1-800-848-9222. Let's go to Joe in Rockland. Joe, your thoughts.
Yeah, hi. We got to be clear where we stand here, I think. I mean, the reason why he's so unpopular, this mayor, is because he stood for the unpopular agenda that the liberal media could not handle. He stood for the Jewish people after October 7th. He stood for against the migrant crisis. He spoke at least about it. I mean, he was very scared to go along with them in action, but at least he spoke about it.
You know, you're right, Joe. You're right. He spoke out, and you're right. He's been a big protector of the Jewish community, too.